Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
We could do a lot better than that on this warm summer day. Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
He's worthy.
Amen.
I don't care what you think and what your circumstance, God is worthy.
Yes, he is.
You know, I just watched a person come in here and sit down. They enjoyed the praise. And then they rolled out. Just now, I just seen the car roll out. I saw it roll in. Spent about 5 minutes with God and it rolled out. You know, that has a tendency to help me with what I need to say to everybody this morning. Those of you out there, welcome to Anointed Gates Church. We welcome you here to praise the Lord with us and worship with him. The Sabbath day is so important. So let it be known right now that if you think you got it going on, and God ain't in that story,
Come on, help us. You're
about to get a rude awakening.
My Lord.
It may not be today, but before it's all said and done, you're going to wish God had been a part of your program.
Amen.
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 Let me pray here. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I just invite you in today. We need you, God, every day. But this is your day. This is the day that you said was a day made for rest. It was a day made for worship. And it was a day to come and see you, Lord God, so that the solution to our problems could be found in you. And because we were in you, everything was going to be all right. We thank you, Lord. So I ask as your speaker that your Holy Spirit help me to deliver the message onto your people that you would want them to hear.
Yes.
For the one who would choose, Lord God, to become a doer of the word that they hear this day. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Man, this has been a rock'em sock'em week. Why? Because it's been a week.
Amen.
Every day, each one of us woke up the next morning. We didn't do it on our own, but with God's help, no matter what was going on, we still woke up to another day. God knew that. That's why he gave us a daily prayer, and he asked us to do certain things every day. Now, God is a wonderful God. He's a good God, and most people don't plan to fail, but they fail to plan. That's not God's story. God put things in motion every day, plans, directions, things to use for guidance, for us to follow, that if we chose to familiarize ourselves with his plan and do what he said and trust it, everything is always going to be all right. No matter what the circumstance, if you go through it and give it to him and leave it there, that's the key. Leave it there. You know, some of us, we go to God and we pray and we give him something. In the next few minutes, we take it back. I'm talking about this morning. I want to talk to you about the title of my sermon is The Solution.
Hallelujah.
Okay? And the solution lies in the directions that God has given each of us for the plans that he has for our life.
Amen.
Now see, I'm choosing my pronouns carefully.
Amen.
Because I didn't say the plans that you had for your life. I said discovering through research, learning, and acceptance the plans God has for your life. Already, that's the sermon, because that's the solution.
Amen.
I don't even know or need to know what your problem is. I know God is the answer. Clap your hands for the Lord. You know, time and time again, we continue to try to do what we think we should do to solve the things we are challenged by in our lives. And time again, we have to go back to the beginning. We have to go back to the drawing board. We got to go back to the start to find out what went wrong, try to figure it out, and do like that movie say, let's do it again. To just to time and time again find we're still not going to work it out. Because the error in many ways, mine, yours, all of us included, at some time or other in your life, has been you've been trying to do it instead of letting God do it for you. Clap your hands if you agree. So that being said, I said, well, Lord, which direction do I go to explain our paradigm, to explain this oxymoron, this understanding that we think we have, that we don't have, but we believe we got it and we keep doing it. It don't work, but yet we still try to depend upon it. Why, Lord, would your believers, people you have created, keep doing what they know they shouldn't do because they believe that's what they should do? And they believe that's what they want to do because somewhere in our DNA, we want to solve our own problems.
Amen.
And he said, your nurture and the words taught to you as you were being brought up told you to handle it yourself. It told you to work it out yourself. It told you you could do it yourself. And that was right and wrong at the same time.
Amen.
Why was it right? That's why it's an oxymoron. Why was it right? Because God does want you to do what you can do for yourself.
Amen. Amen.
But God doesn't stop there. That's only part of the message. God wants you to depend upon Him for the things you cannot do. Yes. And you have to discover to recover. What you cannot do, don't try.
Amen.
God says that's my job to do. So I can give you a quick example that y'all all agree. Those people under the sea the other day who are no longer here with us, they couldn't bring themselves back to the surface, could they?
No, they couldn't.
You can't see your back, can you? You can't fly. Can you? Oh, that's just the short list. There's a long, long list, believers, of things that you cannot do. Don't allow your mind to play tricks on you and tell you you can do something that you cannot do. See, you have to study the Word of God to discover the things that you shouldn't even actually try to do. See, because the human mind, the intellect, possessions, money, property, prestige, socially being acceptable, being popular because you the new star, they pay $2,000 for your ticket to come see you in concert. All that inflates your ego.
Amen.
Gives you this foolish pride.
Jesus.
That starts to tell you you can give 50 concerts without sleeping. That you can take all the drugs you want to and still be okay. That you can make money and don't have to eat. Because they have made you feel that you are so different from the other creations God has made. That you can do really what you still can't do. And I don't care who you are.
Amen.
So I say, Lord, we got to get away from some of this stuff. See, because if I don't get away from it and I practice insanity,
Jesus.
It's going to become a habit for me.
Jesus.
I'm going to do some stuff I know is killing me. I'm going to do some stuff that is destroying me. I'm going to do some stuff that ain't good for me. And I'm going to have a habit because I'm going to keep doing it over and over again. I need an escape plan.
Come on.
I need a way to get away from the things that's taking me away without my permission. I don't agree with them. They're not comfortable for me. I don't like them, yet I still do them. God said, I gave you a whole story about that. I said, what you talking about? He said, then you hear Paul when he said, why do I do what I don't want to do, what I can't do, what I can do, and I know what to do, but I still don't do it, but yet I do what I don't do. It's the Lord that made me do what I do, and it ain't the right thing to do.
Come on. All right, now. The word.
Well, that was in the old days. We still doing it.
Help us.
I said, well, Father, that just give me somebody who just like me. He said, I ain't through talking to you. I said, well, what we gonna do? He said, turn it over to me in prayer. Yeah. And leave it there.
Amen.
I said, well, we've been praying and praying and praying. He said, that ain't all I want. That ain't all you want. Well, what else could you possibly want? I ain't got nothing left but a prayer. I'm beat down, tore up from the floor. I'm helpless, hopeless, penniless. Lord God, I'm almost destroyed. He said, that's where I want you.
That's right.
See, because I don't want you to try no more of your moves.
Yeah.
I want you to be thoroughly convinced you to mess this up so I can show you that I am God. So I said, now, Lord, you got my attention. Because I done tried all my moves and I done ran out. So what we going to do? He said, I'm glad you asked. Because that's why I'm here. He said, in your weakness, I am made strong.
Yeah.
I needed you broken. I needed you thoroughly convinced that you didn't have another move.
Yeah.
I needed you to feel destitute. I needed you to feel destroyed. I needed you to feel everything but one thing. And I didn't want you to feel condemned.
Amen.
Because there's no condemnation. I said it in my New Testament word. There's no condemnation known to man that I espouse. Because I'm not about condemning you. You are my creation. And even in your brokenness, you are still good.
Yes, Lord.
So I ask you, are you tired of making mistakes?
Yes.
I ask you, are you tired of trying to run your life?
Yes.
The one my son paid for. The one that his blood was shed for. The one that I planned for in the first Adam making you lose life. The second Adam that I sent to you, the savior of the world.
Yeah.
He came to redeem you and restore you back onto me. Are you ready for the program? Are you looking for the solution?
Yeah.
I don't know about y'all. I told him, I said, yeah. Yeah, I'm, Lord, you got my attention. I done turned the TV off. I done unplugged the phone. I done shut the windows and locked the doors. Everything in the house got to be quiet. Like the rainstorm when it was lightning, the people told us, be quiet. I'm being quiet like it's a rainstorm because I'm trying to hear everything you got to say.
Yes, Lord.
Because I'm realizing I've come to believe that maybe, just maybe, the solution is going to be found in you. He said, oh, you are listening. I said, yeah. He said, turn to Exodus.
All right now.
He said, you want a way out of your bad life? He said, you want a way out of that bad situation? He said, you want out of that poverty? He said, you want out of that feeling destitute, feeling down, feeling like don't nobody love you, don't nobody care. You want that way into feeling loved because you don't feel loved. You don't feel cared for. You don't feel a part of. I don't know what I done left out, but he talking about those two.
Amen.
He said, I wanted you right there. Because no pain, no gain. He said, it's either going to hurt if you stay there. Oh, it's going to hurt when you try to leave, but you're going to do some pain. But if you ain't ready to do no pain, you ain't ready to gain what I have for you, because even my son had to go through.
Yes,
Lord. Yes, Lord. So I start reading. He sent me to the 16th chapter of Exodus, where we talked about manna and we talked about meat. And see, you first got to have bread before you have meat. See, when you're a child of God, you can't stand the meat, because when I tell you the truth, you're going to hate me.
Amen.
He said, those who will love the world will hate me, because I'm going to tell you exactly the opposite of what the world is trying to tell you. So if you're getting ready to get into a real relationship, a lasting relationship, a steadfast, immovable, unshakable relationship with God, one that you're going to be consistent with, diligent with, one where you ain't going to leave 5 minutes before the miracle. Then you need to put your seatbelt on. You need to buckle up.
Yes.
Because commitment to God ain't easy, but it's possible.
Yes.
Commitment to God gonna change some things, but it's gonna give you so much, so much more.
Yes.
Clap your hands for the Lord. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
So, the 16th chapter of Exodus, I'm only gonna read a few verses, but I read, and I would tell you, recommend to you, suggest to you, that you read the full chapter of the 16th chapter of Exodus and go on to the 17th chapter. Why? Because this is the area where God is saving a whole community of people. He's saving the whole Israelite race that was enslaved, who had just ran away from the Pharaoh, and they were trying to go into what God had said was the promises that he had, the promised land. They were in route. They weren't there. They were exiting Egypt, but headed to the promised land, and they were murmuring and complaining.
Yes, Lord.
Some of them say, why didn't we stay back there in Egypt in slavery and just die? At least we had three hots in a cot.
Yeah.
It's hot out here in the desert, because when you go through a desert, you get thirsty. You get thirsty for life. You get thirsty for change. You get thirsty for something different. When you're in a desert in your life, when things ain't going right for you, you cry, you snot, you lay down, you ball up in a fetal position, you're in pain, your stomach is twisted, you don't feel like eating, you can't talk to nobody, and if the truth ain't in you, you don't even want to tell the truth and talk about it. I'm asking you about what's wrong with you, and you're talking about your leg hurt. You can run 5 miles, but your leg hurt. But your mind going crazy, and your insides is turned outside. You've been turned inside out from the pain of life on life terms. What's hitting you that you can't handle, but you just have not given it to God.
Amen. Amen.
So what was happening with these people who was complaining? They were talking about, we out here in the desert, we ain't got nothing to eat. We thirsty and we ain't got nothing to drink. So God gave some instructions. And that's why you better start loving your leaders. I didn't say you had to agree with me. I didn't even tell you to like me. I told you to listen to me, because I ain't got no reason to lie. And see, Moses had no reason to lie to the people. So when they start complaining, he didn't holler at them like Pastor Cliff might holler at you. He said, Lord, what you want me to do with those people? They were no longer his people. The scripture says it. See, that's different from, Lord, what you want me to do with our people or my people? He said, what you want me to do with those people? God said, get your staff and get them all gathered together and get them next to the ark and pick up a big rock. And when they complain, when I tell you, slap the rock and they'll get their water. And that's what Moses did. Y'all know the story. So already desire, that's what's wrong with us. Your desire was satisfied. You wanted thirsty for some water, but see, you was wanting natural water. God was trying to use your thirst for water to try to tell you you thirsting for some things in life that you're going about the wrong way to receive. You're trying to get some things that's already yours, and you don't recognize it, so you're going about getting it wrong. But he used that example, strike the rock.
Yes.
He gave them directions to strike the rock. And it satisfied people's desire. What happens to you when you get what you think you want? There's a psychological change in your brain that when you get what you want, you think that makes you happy. But see, just like that disconnect that happens to some of us when we go from being a little baby and people doing everything for us to learning that in life we got to start doing some things for ourselves. And when people don't do what we want them to do, we get disconnected and don't feel like life is right because somebody ain't living and doing what we want them to live and do for. And all of a sudden now life ain't worth living because we ain't getting what we want.
Help somebody in the name of
God. Yes, Lord.
We forget about God. Because that ain't what we're looking for. We don't desire God. We desire that thing, that person, that place, that thing. And God said in the Exodus, he said, give them the water, but don't give them no food.
Come on.
See, because when you get water, you partially satisfy. But after you've had your thirst quenched, what you want next? Huh? See, we are creatures of habit. We get something and we want some more. Look, I mean, we gave two chicken wings to everybody. Somebody wanted three. Huh? Somebody wanted five. Huh? But you got to know how to tame your desires. You got to fast and pray to get control of yourself. To get some discipline about not always getting what you want and still being all right. Because getting what you want gonna lead you to hell if you don't think you can live when you don't get what you want. Because when you want what you want, when you want it, and you want it as much as you want it, and you want it when you want it, no matter what people telling you about, you shouldn't have that right now. Then you're headed for destruction. Because why should I give my 7-year-old son a brand new car and tell him go drive and have fun? It's not time to give him the car.
Right.
Why should I give a person who's in the hospital and can't chew a T-bone steak? It's not time for that kind of meat. But let's talk about what happened in the desert, because we're in a spiritual desert right now. The world is in a spiritual desert right now. Right now, and I ain't gonna blame the pandemic, I'm just gonna blame circumstance. You better tell you, when life tells you how big your circumstance is, you better learn how to tell circumstance how big your God is. Listen. God said they got hungry. It was the third day, and they hadn't eaten. And he decided to be the solution. So what did he do? I'm listening. I'm like, I'm riding. This is like I was at the movies. He started dropping manna from heaven all over the desert. It was like bread flakes, corn flakes dropping down. But he gave some instruction, y'all hard-headed believers. He said, only get what you need for the day. The Bible in 16 says some didn't gather quite enough. They were probably lazy. We got some of those. Some tried to get more than they needed. We got some of those. He said some, those, he said, collected just the right amount, right? Let me tell you what happened. See, Because I would rather read this whole thing to you, but the Spirit is telling me, let you read it for yourself. Because if you get an understanding for yourself, you can find out what's wrong with you. Because there's something wrong with each one of us. There's something to work on in each one of us. There's something about your faith. There's something about the way you serve God. There's something about the excuses that you make on a daily basis that God says, I have a solution. I have a transformative change that I want to affect in your life, because right now you think you're okay and you dying too. So those of you out there trying to get more than you need, God said the maggots ate it up to prevent you from getting your way. I sent maggots and I made it decay and I made it spoil. Because I told you, don't get more than you need. Get what you need and back up. What happened to those who didn't get enough? He didn't. God is a merciful God. He didn't punish you for being lazy, you sluggard. He made other believers learn to share. So he helped those who had enough help give those who didn't have enough what they needed, so they too would have enough. Because God was trying to help his universal family learn that we all need each other. And that one who is strong could help the one who is weak. And that they could all become unified strong because of the love and unity that they share with each other. He did this in the desert. When you know, like when you're giving your tithe and you say, I ain't got but $98. And your tithe is $9.80. And you say, I can't give but $2 because my rent is $110. And he said, why don't you let me bless your 90%? He says, see, you're not believing me because I'm asking you, giving you specific directions. That if you were to follow, then I could follow it up with the blessing that I already have in store. I told you, stop trying to get it for yourself. God says you already got it. I'm just holding it back until you obey me, until you trust me, until you believe me. I got you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, he does. Hallelujah.
Yes, he does. I got that woman. I got that man. I got that husband. I got that wife. I got that house. I got that car. I got that health. I got that wealth. I got it.
Yes.
It all belongs to me.
Yes.
I can't release it to you because you're not ready. You don't believe my son, so I must deduce that you don't believe me.
That's right. Amen.
I got to back up here. We have personal problems because we have the inability to accept our own personal responsibility. So what I'm trying to tell you is, God says that when you become responsible enough to do what I'm asking you to do what I'm directing you to do, you're going to place yourself in a position like an outfielder who's going after a home run hit ball. I'm going to teach you just how to go up and stretch yourself out, catch it, and make the play that nobody will forget for the rest of life, for the rest of history. See, I'm trying to get you to follow me so you can get some things done in your life that people would call a miracle. So, I'm going to get off the manna story because everybody ate bread, but ain't nobody ate no meat. And see, in this church, all y'all done had some bread. But some of y'all ain't ate no meat. Because when you get to the meat portion of the meal, you're going to be ready to serve God.
Yeah.
Not play with God. When you get the meat of the word of God, you're going to be prepared to be a friend of God. When you get to the point where you are chewing on God's meat, his word, eating his word, living his word, believing his word, and won't turn from his word, the meat, all of a sudden, you're a friend of God.
Yes.
One he won't fail to answer. One who, when you call, see, some of y'all calling God, but y'all ain't dedicated to him, so he hear you. He just like one of them people you be talking to and they ain't listening. You're talking right in their face. You know they hear you, but they acting just like you ain't talking. You can say that breath for longer life. Y'all know him. Every one of y'all got people around. You ask them how they doing, they start into the story, and you be like, oh my God. Why did I ask them how they doing? That's how some of us treat God.
Come on, help us.
Some of us treat God that when he's giving out his instructions, we're watching TV. Yeah. We're on our phone.
Jesus.
We're partying. Yeah.
Jesus.
We having procreations.
Yeah.
We eating.
Yeah.
We shopping. Yeah. Now we at the casino. Trying to get a miracle. Because it ain't designed for you to win. It's designed for you to come and lose again and again. I told you we do things, wanting, we do the same things expecting a different result. That is the definition of insanity.
Yes.
If it didn't work last time, and it didn't work the time before that, or the many times before that, what in your mind, your ever-loving mind, would make you think it's going to work this time? The human mind will play tricks on you. It's called denial. Denial is don't even know I am lying. But some of y'all then got worse. I checked the record. Denial is outdone by outright refusal.
Right.
Some of us know it don't work, but we like it so much, we got to do it. So I'm going to just have to pass that one, God. And see, have you told God you love him today? See, God shows us every day that he loves us because he woke you up this morning. The alarm clock didn't wake you up this morning. You are breathing without a machine, every one of you in here. That's God moving your lungs.
Yes.
You are seeing me because God is making your brain work with your retina, work with your optic nerve, work with your eyeball. To tell you that her dress is red and my shirt look like me.
Brown.
One of the people said, I don't care what color you call me. Call me godly.
Yes, right.
Color me Lord. Don't forget to call me when it's time to pray.
Yes.
See, I ain't got to pray like you. I still got to pray.
That's
my language to God.
Hallelujah.
See, I ain't got to be loud. I ain't got to be soft. You ain't got to hear it, but I still got to do it.
Yeah. Amen.
See, because
Amen.
When I want to talk to God,
yeah.
I got to know to speak his language.
Yeah.
And his language is the voice in my head, in my mouth, and in my heart that he gave me, created me with to speak to him. But he gave me something else that some of us don't use. They said we only use 9% of our brain. See, some of us pray and forget to wait and listen for the answer.
Amen.
That's called meditation. That means a quiet space in God.
Yeah.
See, in Isaiah, it's either the 36th chapter or the 63rd chapter. Fault me with dyslexia because I'm turning the numbers around. It's either 36 or 63. If you read that chapter, God says you're going to find him in the quiet.
Yeah.
When you steal yourself, stop moving. Stop doing something else while you're trying to hear from him. Be totally still. That's why, without all this intelligence, The older people used to know what to do in the rain.
Yes. Come
on. See, when it was thundering and lightning, boom, 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 boom. And you still want to watch the Flintstones? They told you, turn that doggone TV off. They ain't saying like that. And they didn't ask twice.
That's right.
It wouldn't be no temper tantrum from a 3-year-old. They get knocked over the couch. I'm just trying to say the solution. See, because when they eased the Pledge of Allegiance out of the schools, when they wouldn't let us say "In God We Trust" in the school, when we wouldn't, when they didn't want us to say the name Jesus.
Come on, all right, now talk about it.
You want me to tell you how I know there's power in that name? We were praying for a destitute city yesterday. We were a group of people that had gathered on a Saturday to pray for the benefit of God, the city, ourselves, and others. And do you know that it shook the foundations of the city so much that they called the police, they called the park director, they got Metro Parks, who finna give $17 million to that city to fix up a destitute park that we was praying for. And they called some people who thought they had rented the park and said, "Y'all praying too much. We need this space." And none of it was effective. We prayed so much the ducks got in line. We prayed so much the raccoons came down and sat watched. We prayed so much that the ducks called the white birds they don't get along with and told them to have a seat. The police mouth looked like it. Somebody had took thread and sewed his mouth shut. He was scared to say one word, but the moment he showed up, we prayed for him too. When the park director got there, we prayed for him. He couldn't even tell us what we had did wrong. We prayed so hard that the people who came to party, drink, and drug couldn't even turn on the music. They started packing up saying, "We gotta leave this place." We moved to another location and it drew sinners toward us just to hear what we were praying about. And at the same time, it convinced every one of us that prayer is powerful and prayer is real. And we can use prayer to change things. Because if you don't think your life needs changing, that means you ain't praying.
Right. You better talk about it.
Because if you're praying, the solution, if you're praying, you ought to be changing.
Yes.
And if you ain't changing, you ain't praying.
Yes.
So if you want to change, pray for the change and then do what the prayers say do.
Yes.
The solution.
Yes.
But let me get back to this thing about manna. Because y'all full now. Y'all had something to drink. Y'all had something to eat. You couldn't get more. You couldn't get too little. Everybody had it just right. Remind me of the Three Bears story. It's just right. Right? So we happy. But we still not positioned. Because we on our way to the promised land. Anointed Gates, we're on our way to the promised land. We're not there yet. There's still work to do. So what did the leader, the pastors of that day, was Moses. Moses grabbed Joshua. We got some Joshuas in here.
Yeah,
some people who will serve while the other ones sit on their grand imagination. Or got something to do. They too busy. You know, they come in, they'll rob us of some praise. They won't even help us sing, but they'll pop their finger and tap their foot. And now that they feel better, they're going back out in the world and get some more sin. And then they'll need us again. And that's when we'll sin when they come back. See, because some people use God like that. They only use God when they're in trouble. They don't serve him. They don't support his church. They don't believe in helping another brother in Christ. They just want what they want when they want to. See, that total self-centeredness, that selfishness, that thing what makes them think the world revolves around them, that comes to any of us who don't have God in us. Because what we do, we have anger and we have resentments and we have fears that we don't find easy to talk about, but they conduct our lives. Because if I'm fearful of you, then I'm afraid of you. If I'm angry with you, I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to be bothered with you. And if I resent you, I can have a whole loaf of bread and still resent you got one slice. And we got to use God to replace those kind of things, because that's how you deal with life when you don't have God. Anger, resentment, and fear. But you can replace it with love, faith, and acceptance.
Yes.
See, God's word will give you some love. And love will change a multitude of sins. Yes. And then faith in God will give you direction and self-discipline. But acceptance will make you be calm in the midst of a storm.
Yes.
See, acceptance, God's word already tells us we're going to go through some things. He says, but with me, you can make it through. See, without God, you think you're going to die in whatever you suffer. But with God, you're going to get to the other side. Let me make a side note here. A strong woman is not born. A strong woman becomes that out of the storms that she goes through. When she gets to the other side of the storm, a strong woman has learned from what she has suffered. And she makes a change in herself, in her program, in what she believes and what she's willing to do. See, because a strong woman will change the things that ain't right in her life. I'm talking about a strong woman. I ain't talking about a silly woman.
Amen.
I ain't talking about a weak woman. See, listen. That's why God says when a man findeth a wife, he findeth a good thing. Let me put it to you this way. In the family unit, the man's supposed to be the lead, but he's supposed to be a godly man that's leading because he's affecting everybody else. And the woman is supposed to be the helper of the father, because he is godly. And it means he needs to be godly. And I ain't talking about playing God and faking God and what you got make you think you God. See, the mother is supposed to share the love and spread it around. But she's supposed to get her juice from him. See, so if he ain't giving you your juice, you're a fool to give you to him, because all y'all messed up. See, because the kid is going to copy after the father. So if the father ain't godly, the kid ain't going to be godly. You smiling because he's cute now, but he's going to be in jail or dead later.
That's right.
And I don't care what you do, because you ain't going to always be his influence. You're his influence now because his whole world depends on you. But what about when you're not his only influence? What will he do?
That's right.
He's going to do what he see you do, not what you say. He's going to watch you. If you go to school, if you go to church, if you believe in God, he's going to go to school. He's going to go to church. He's going to believe in God. If he see you get high, if he see you drink, if he see you hoe around, he's going to do that too.
Yes.
But so is the girl going to do that.
Yes.
Because our children are imitators of us.
Yes.
And you can't change that. They're going to do what you do. So I got to get this point in so I can give y'all the hope that comes out of this message. Listen, Moses told Joshua, go fight the Amalekites, because just before they was coming into the promised land, the giants were there, the Amalekites. And God said, you're either going to cut down trees or you're going to fight the Amalekites. So Moses told Joshua, go fight. Just like your big brother when you was in school and somebody jumped on you. He said, come on, let's go back up to the school.
Right.
You going to fight. You scared, but you got to go fight. Right?
Right. Your sister too.
Now, Moses was like your big brother. Because this is what he told Joshua. Moses told Joshua, he said, you're going to fight the Amalekites, but me and Aaron, we're going up the hill. We're going to oversee the fight. He said, and when I raise my arms up, you're going to win the fight.
Yeah.
And what God showed him was, every time Moses' arms went down, Joshua and them start losing the fight. So what was God trying to show the church right there?
Come on.
Jesus. We all here to win the fight.
Yeah.
I'm not here to complain about you, to judge you. Your life is your life. It's your gift. And everybody in your life is your gift.
Amen.
But I do need to say to you, just like every time they held Moses' arms up, the church won. And every time they let his arm fall down, the church lost. And I'm trying to tell y'all, Anointed Gates, y'all got to begin to stop looking at the leaders of this church as the enemy, as the person you want to be in a fight with, as the person you want to stress out. You need to begin to hold up the arms of the pastors. You need to begin to want to stop doing everything you want to do in your life and start helping the pastors to make this church a wonderful place to worship God and grow in the spirit and grow in your faith. You need to get busy with service, because service won't change your life, but it sure help you discover your life. And that if you start to deal with the fact it's time to stop on the seventh day. To give God glory for your life. By how he tells you to proper go through life. Pray to him. Pray for your leaders. Pray for your local church. Pray for your family. Pray for your house. Pray for yourself. He said, hold up their arms. So you can be strong. I oftentimes recall Pastor Renee saying, see, if I was you, I would go home, and before I came to church, I would be praying for my pastor so that they could have a good word in their mouth for me. And we come here and want to have a pissing contest. I don't like him because he's cute. I ain't getting no laughs on that one. You ain't got no business judging nobody. You ain't got no business criticizing nobody. You ain't got nothing to do but pray for everybody. Pray to God. Pray for yourself. Pray for this church. Help the pastors. Help your kids. Help other people's kids. Help your brother and sister in Christ. Share the manna. Share the manna. Share the manna. Everybody is supposed to get only what they need. And when they had come, when they answered God's direction, the word of God says he sent a bunch of quails. Quails is real good, tender chicken meat. How many of y'all like chicken? Raise your hand. Well, quails taste 10 times better than chicken.
They good.
And they just right. It ain't too much. It ain't too little. It's like a Cornish hen. You got your own personal two wings, two legs, two breasts, and two thighs. You even get the back, but they little.
They little.
One gonna do you. Quails. The word says, because we have become friends to God, because we had listened to God, he sent the meat.
Yes.
See, God will send you meat in your life when you listen to God in your life, when you do what you're supposed to do in your life. God will send you what you need. See, because I'm trying to tell you, stop trying to get it on your own, because you already got it. God got it. You just got to listen to God and trust God, because it's already yours. He just waiting to win. He need to give it to you.
Yes. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
And that's whatever you want. God's so good that he even gives you sometimes some things you don't need. Because you can't even have them. You done prayed and you've been good, and God said okay, and he give it to you, and then you got to pray it away. It's the truth anyhow.
It's the truth.
See, because you didn't do your research. God said don't be unequally yoked. So why should I have a wife that don't believe in God so she can give me grief? Or why should she have a husband who don't believe in God so the house can be total chaos? See, God said, do not forsake the fellowship of the brethren, because you need to be around other believers. Because imagine trying to serve God, obey God, believe in God, be all about God in an atmosphere of people who don't believe in God at all.
Amen.
That's an awful difficult task.
Yes.
You can't talk to nobody. People don't want to hear, man, shut up all that while I'm trying to get my high on. Look, I've been waiting for her for 10 weeks. You better go on. That's how we talk. We act as though God is a light switch. You want him, you can get him. When you don't want him, no, this is like you don't want him. That's like when you want him. You think you can turn him on when you want him and turn him off when you don't. That ain't how God works. That's how we work him. And that's why he don't work. See, God works if you work him, but he don't want to work for you if you don't want to work for him. It's an exchange. God says that the way I work for him is to believe in him. Have faith in him. Trust him. Obey him. That's me paying God some attention. And God doing for me exceedingly abundantly more than I could think, say, or ask. Is God responding to my behaviors on my faith? So I got to get away from telling us what the problem is.
Yes, sir. Say something.
So I can get into the solution.
Solution, yes.
And here it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Take it if you want it.
Mm-hmm.
Skip it if you don't. God is looking for faithful, consistent, courageous, and determined people. He's looking for people who are going to be consistently here, determined, diligent, willing to do what they can instead of talking what they can't. Huh? God is issuing a call to all of us, every one of us getting a call from God, because this ain't no time to be playing with your faith. You need God like you need air to breathe. All right? So he's issuing a call to those who, no matter what is coming down the pipe, that they want to still be godly about what he is saying. See, you got to love God to want to be about God when things ain't godly. You got to be godly in the midst of the storm, but he give you the power to be godly in the midst of the storm. And I'm yet praying for some of you who your world is so worldly that it's hard for you to get to God, because they don't want you to receive them, because you're going to be forever different. God is issuing a call to those who are going to decide to take up his cross and follow him.
Yes.
See, I ain't talking about just loving God or knowing God. I'm talking about following God. God's calling people to follow him. You need to understand that when you look at other religions and you see how diligent they are going to church and going to the mosque and praying and putting down their own personal preferences on what they're going to do, because it's time to worship God. God is looking for those in the Christian faith who are going to worship him like that, in spite of who they are, in spite of who they related to, in spite of what they have, in spite of what they know, in spite of how they feel. God is calling you to him, the solution. God has a call to those who understand that he requires them to be steadfast, immovable, to do more and more concerning him instead of less and less concerning him. Believers are now being required to do what is right in the sight of God and in the sight of man. No longer can you be a willy-nilly Christian. You claim Christianity when you're around your cute pastor. But outside of that, you hell on wheels.
Yes. Tell the truth.
In the main seat in the jet.
Tell the truth.
One day you're here, and the next day you're gone. Where you going to be when your turn comes? We got to invest ourselves first in the gospel, and then in our plans, in order that we begin to have efforts that's going to last from generation to generation. You want to change how your family is living, how they turn it out, how it keeps repeating itself over and over again? You be the difference. You be the change. You decide that you're going to stop doing what y'all doing that you shouldn't be doing. Paul said it best. I wish I didn't do what I always do that I didn't want to do that I did anyway. I know that's some of y'all's story. I know you long been since wanting to quit some of the things you're doing, some of the things that's happening, some of the things you experience in your life. You've been tired of it a long time ago. You're almost tired of yourself. But you still ain't turn it over to God. And you still ain't did what he told you to do. And the funny thing about it, well, we told a person yesterday, God going to get you because you know what to do. You just refuse to do it.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Don't blame me. I had a person, they're going to go on name. They had the nerve to say they were just like me. And I thought about that. That kind of puzzled me. A few hours later at my home, I looked at my wife. I said, well, you know what? How in the heck? That they say they just like me. They don't go to church. I do. They don't believe in God. They talk about him, but I serve him. I'm doing all right. I done turned away from a whole lot of wicked things that I could still do. I may not be the cutest. I'm a 9 out of 10. The knife may not be the sharpest knife in the drawer, but it still will cut the fruit. So, you know, you have to have self-discipline to tame your spirit because flesh desire is flesh desire. Huh?
That's right.
It's only God that's keeping me from sinning worse than I will sin when I fall. Like I fall. We all fall short. But when you got God in you, you get some discipline about yourself that you wouldn't have otherwise. That's why I got to keep God in me. God is my control center. God is my admiral in chief. He's not that because he's stepped out of heaven and decided to be that. He's that because I believe what he said. I believe his promises. I believe and I trust in him. I obey him. I read him. I learn him. And then I do what I read, said, prayed for, and waited to hear from. And it changes you. It transforms you. You go from being a pig to a pork chop. Have you ever seen a pork chop say oink? Have you ever seen bacon go back to being a pig? Transformation means you change permanently. I ain't talking about being a pig and getting out the mud and putting on a suit, because some of us are. We dress up real good, but we live in dirty. We're just not clean. That's not the solution. God says, I change you forever. See, there's a difference between independence and freedom. Independence means that you getting to do what you want to do. You independent. Freedom means you free from doing what you shouldn't do. You free.
Amen. Amen.
See, if I was independent, I might get high by myself.
Amen. Tell the truth.
But if I'm free, I ain't going to get high at all.
That's it.
If I'm independent, I might only work on the three-wheel bandit at the casino. I ain't going to the crap table like I used to know. But if I'm free, I ain't going to the casino.
That's right.
If I'm free, can I go here? If I'm free, I'm celibate.
Yeah, that's right.
And still want something. Want it real bad. Real, real bad. Real, real, real bad. But that makes me rush to doing what I need to do so I can get something. If you want to know something, I just gave you the short version of meeting the co-pastor.
Amen.
I did everything right.
Amen.
And you know one other thing I did? I met about 20 of y'all before I met her, because I had to meet y'all too. I had 6 different meetings. I met 2 of the elders, an assistant pastor. I met the former mother-in-law who is still like a mother-in-law to her. I met the family. I met you little nosy people. I met the naysayer and the supporter. It was only two of them. Thank you. And I met her mom and dad. And still was only able to go to breakfast and lunch for a while. I'm just telling you the truth. See, the solution is to change how you're doing what you're doing. If what you're doing ain't working for you and you want it to work for you, change how you're doing what you do. I know y'all don't want to hear this because some of y'all still stuck. I'm preaching about the solution. And I still love it. You ain't got to like it. Because I know you don't. Like he need to get his self from in front of us. Look, listen. It takes a real commitment to live your life for God. All right? You especially need commitment when no one else around you is serving God. That's why God said, don't forsake the fellowship of the brethren. You see, your hopes are not in the coming year. Your hopes are in the one who is coming back. No man can stay in one place forever. God formed us. Sin deformed us. The Bible informs us. But Jesus transforms us. Yeah. And that's why we need Jesus. Clap your hands to the Lord. Yeah. Yeah. Listen, I don't know much. But three things I know. Three things I do. There is a God.
Yes.
His words are true.
Yes.
And if you stay close to them, he's going to bring you through. Faith makes all things possible. Love makes all things easy. Hope makes all things work. And family makes life worth living. If it doesn't challenge you, it won't change you. No pain, no gain. You can either have results or you can have excuses, yes. But you can't have both.
All right, now. You better talk about it.
That's right.
The pain you go through today will be the strength that you have for tomorrow.
Yeah. Mama.
You should seek progress a little each day,
yes.
Because when you do, it's going to add up to big results by tomorrow.
Amen.
Be stronger than your excuses. When you feel like quitting, think about why you started in the first place.
Amen.
Amen.
Now that's good.
When you're in your own lane, you flow with the traffic. It's when you get in other people's lane that you crash.
Well.
Galatians 6:5 says, for each will have to bear his own load.
Yeah.
So listen and understand me. Some people can have a whole loaf of bread and still be jealous of your one slice.
Yes. Yes.
The enemy hides wolves in sheep's clothing. But God hides ferocious lions in little bitty lambs. And be the lion and the lamb that God created for you. Isaiah 40:29 says he gives strength to the weary and he increases power of the weak. So the more you sweat now during times of peace, the less you have to bleed when it's time for war. You got to do your work while it's day. We got to stop resting just because we think everything is all right. Amen. Let me tell you something. Strong women are not simply born. They are made by the storms that they walk through. So continue to be fearless. Don't dig up in doubt what you planted in faith. And let me tell you about God's peace, because I'm tired of this peace that is peaceful until you want to pull your nap, your Mac, your 9, your 357. Yeah, I know y'all. What I miss? A 44? What I miss? A machine gun? A cannon? A tank? I can't wait till I start to see tanks going down 152nd Street. I know I'm going to see it in this lifetime. Peace. God's peace. She's talking about Pastor Clifford, because you're real serious now. You ain't even worried about being cute now.
Amen.
Peace. God's peace.
Yes.
Peace does not mean being in a place where there is no noise, where there's no trouble, where there's no hard work. That ain't peace. Peace means to be in the midst of all those things and still be calm in your heart. Still be ready to serve God in your heart. Peace means being good even in the storms. And you need strength for that. You don't need cute for that. You don't need faith for that. You need faith for that. And you need God, because that strength only comes from the Lord. Clap your hands for God. Listen, don't worry about the things you can't control.
Amen.
Sometimes we just have to pray.
Yeah.
We have to put it in God's hand, and we have to leave it there. See, that's what most of us need to learn, how to put something in God's hand and leave it there. Y'all put it in his hand and then still try to control it.
Yeah.
That ain't what's happening. God is telling you today to be still. Stop stressing yourself of what is going on.
Yes.
Stop trying to figure it out on your own.
Yes.
With your understanding. Stop fighting for it, because I done told you, most of the stuff you want is already yours.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
God is saying this to all of us. Leave that to me. Put it in my hands. I got you. See, we see that in the movies where it say, I got you. And we, or your friend tell you, I got you. Say less. I got you. They don't even say more no more. Say less. I got you. And God said, you ain't got to say nothing at all. I got you. And I'm trusting him that he got me. I had a shirt on yesterday. We was in that park. Those who saw me, what did it say? God got me. See, I'm convinced. I don't need you to have me. You laughing. You think this a joke. When your butt get on fire, you're going to want God to be the fire department. And see, there were some people who was playing with God yesterday. And that's my opinion. And they didn't see me jump in the middle. Because you know what? It ain't up to me to tell you to stop doing what you're doing. You love it. You like it. I love it. You want to keep doing it? Keep doing it. It ain't got nothing to do with me. What you eat don't send me to the bathroom. I got sense enough to know that my position, her position, our position is only to suggest to you what you should do. Our position is that when you decide that's what you want to do, is to help you do it. Our position is not to try to control you, not to try to redirect you, not to try to tell you what your brain gonna tell you something different about anyway. Our position is to be ready for you when you walk through the door. And let me tell you something about a door, because Jesus talks about knock, he'll answer the door. Or when he knocking, you answer the door. Let me tell you something about a door. A door is only good when you come through it. I done seen people die in the door. because they didn't do nothing but get to the door. I got a cousin that died from the pandemic at the door. You got to go through the door. So don't you dare give up. God says, take my yoke. It's easy. I'm here right now to change everything. Not some things, everything. I want you to stop losing your focus and pay attention. He is my servant talking to you for me. He is not talking to you from himself. He don't even like doing what he's doing. And I don't. I'm here to make it all better. Trust me. Serve me. Believe me. Get delivered by me. God gave you purpose on purpose. You built for the fight. Keep on pushing even if it don't seem like you're succeeding, because God says do what I say. God can't lose. That means you can't do nothing but win. Clap your hands for the Lord. I'm asking y'all to join Anointed Gates Army. I'm asking y'all to join God for real. I had some of my prefaces. God say, don't have no prefaces, because some of the people you want ain't coming.
Come on now.
He said, open the door and say, come all will. And those who come and answer me will answer me, and you get busy with the fight. You get your next Joshua, and you put him on assignment. You be the colonel. Let me, God, be the admiral. Admiral in chief. Chief of staff, and giving out the directions. You give them the directions I give you, and they'll do the right thing too. God wants the people willing to follow, who love him, need him, trust him, willing to obey him, but most of all, love and serve him. Clap your hands for the Lord. Clap your hands for the Lord. Let's join in completely. This is the spiritual enlistment group. You can sign up for service here today. Join Army. God's army for real. Enlist completely. Join permanently. Join in career style. I don't want you just to be here today. Some of you, I just seen you. I need to see you next week. I need you to see the week after that. I need to see you at Bible study. I need you to say, how can I help? I need you to come down on a Tuesday when we sleep in the yard. I need you to come down on a Thursday when we paint the window. I need you to come down on a Saturday when we're moving something out the kitchen. Join us. We need you. We want you. Gotta have you. The battle is not ours. It's the Lord's. So let's posse up. We got some posses in the spirit too, like y'all got some posses, some ride or dies out there in the world. Let's posse up and really join together to watch God's plan on what he plans for us to do. And let's sit in the passenger seat and let the Lord do the driving. Because where we're headed, they call it the promised land. And I don't know about you, but I'm looking for my house in the promised land. And I want my grass to be cut. And I want pastor to be, and I want us to have some pretty flowers. And I want a lot of space for kids to play. And I want a few picnic tables, not too many, because some of y'all are greedy. I want some picnic tables where some of y'all can come and eat just enough. Just enough, because we ain't buying, but just enough. And then I want us to pray. And I want us to give thanks to God. And I want us to appreciate and have gratitude for life, because God is life. God gives life. God makes life. God repairs life. God restores life. Take it to God in prayer. And I close with this. For those of you who are full of anger, for those of you who are full of resentments, you don't like this. You don't like that. You don't like him. You don't like her. You don't like directions. That's the problem. You don't have directions. That's why you ain't reading God's word, because it's directive. I'm just telling you, do like the OJ said and get on board. Come on down, just as you are. We got some water to cool you off. You know, they be talking about holy water and all that in the world. Like, to talk about, yeah, they talking about parting the Red Sea and the burning bush and all that. Oh, this ain't religious. We ain't religious either.
Hallelujah.
We need you to come down if you want your life repaired. We need you to come on by if you want something fixed. We need you to come on by if you're ready to help somebody instead of yourself only. And when you do, when you come and you're broken, we're going to help God to fix you, to restore you, to redeem you, and to place you back in your proper position. Because even though you feel broke, God says he wants to fix you. Clap your hands for the Lord. Replace that anger and that resentment, that fear. Replace it with love. Replace it with faith. Replace it with acceptance. We must not hate them who have done wrong to us. For as soon as we start to hate them, is really when we become just like them.
Come on, that was good.
Understand, God wants you to do something different. And I invite you to Anointed Case to be a soldier for the Lord.
Yeah.
Won't you join in with Christ? Pastor, come forward and offer an opportunity for somebody who's not with us to join in with us, so that our family can continue to grow in the Lord. God bless you and God keep you. Clap your hands if something you heard makes sense to you.
We're going to get ready to end the broadcast. We want to thank you. We want to thank all of you all for listening to the message today. Being a part of what God is doing in this ministry. And if you would like to support this ministry, you can go to anointedgates.org, hit the give tab, and you can give that way. If you need personal prayer, you can dial 216-249-5811. Leave a message and a live person will call you back and pray with you. And you have a blessed day. Amen.